Funding for Schaeferillus is provided by Squarespace, the sponsor of today's video.
2022 was the year Sonic 2 came out, and it was pretty good, but other movies were better, so we're talking about those now. Tar was a good movie about a lady who gets canceled because someone makes a YouTube poop of them. Matilda the Musical is pretty good, however it didn't have Danny DeVito, so 0 out of 10. The movie with the little shell kid was cute. Pinocchio was really good, but I hated Pinocchio and didn't get a chance to watch Pinocchio.
Father, when can I leave to be on my own?
But I assume it's amazing. This was also the year I watched Pinocchio for the first time, but I'm pretty sure that movie didn't come out in 2022. Probably came out in like 2005 or something. This was the year I gave up on Marvel, but at least Black Panther 2 was pretty good. There's a bunch of other movies I could mention in this intro, but instead, I'm gonna devote the rest of it to Dinosaur Hotel 2. So, the premise of Dinosaur Hotel is that it's the Hunger Games, except you have to survive a hotel filled with bad CGI dinosaurs. The first movie came out in 2021, and it features the worst child acting ever put on film. Sadly, the second one doesn't have the bad child acting in it as much, but it does have this guy named Jeremy, who is truly unhinged in the best possible way, and he made this movie an absolute delight. There's also this announcer guy who's commentating on the game, except they forgot to put anything behind him on the green screen. This is a real movie. Currently, only 29 people have logged this on Letterboxd, but I want you to be the change you want to see in the world, and go watch this movie yourself. Get Dinosaur Hotel 2 some more logs, because it is easily the most epic film of 2022. Anyway, here's 15 films that are far less epic, but they were okay too, I guess.
Number 15.
Triangle of Sadness is a movie I'm very, very mixed on. Normally, that would only justify an honorable mention, rather than squeaking its way into the top 15. But the thing is, the first 90 minutes of this movie are up there as some of my favorite media of 2022. There's just something so delightfully off about this wacky, satirical, rich person cruise in the best way possible, making for a ton of hilarious moments, not to mention really impressive long takes. I was absolutely delighted by this wonderful, weird little film that consistently engaged me, and I considered calling it one of my top 5 favorite films of the whole year. Then we got to the third act, and the movie took the biggest nosedive I've ever seen a third act take in my entire life. The last hour of this film is genuinely so boring. It has a couple good laughs reminiscent of the first two acts, and there's a solid new character with a really good performance given by the actress who played her. But there's no momentum, there's no intrigue. Everything that was being established in the first two acts that I liked was mostly abandoned for this aimless, pointless, agonizingly overlong nightmare of a third act. Definitely still check it out, because that first hour and a half is legitimately fantastic and so entertaining. And maybe you'll like the rest of it, I don't know. Me personally though, if I ever watch this again, I'm turning it off as soon as I see the part 3 text on screen. Young's just 14. I loved Get Out and didn't like Us, so I didn't really know what to expect from Nope. Fortunately, while not quite hitting the highs of Get Out, Nope was good enough to prove that Jordan Peele definitely isn't a one-hit wonder in the horror department. Basically, there's a giant butthole in the sky and Wakabi really wants pictures of it. But then Invincible is like, I'm gonna charge admission to see the giant butthole. And that goes well. It's a really interesting story that delves into how incapable people are of looking away from horrific shit, as well as the toll man-made entertainment productions can take on unwitting animals. One of the most unique horror movies I've ever seen, with likable characters and a ton of legitimately unnerving moments. But damn it, if you're gonna have Keith David in your movie, can you please have him in it for more than 5 minutes?
Number 13!
Enter Galactic is proof that animation is the best medium for basically any genre. It's a pretty simple New York City rom-com, but with likable characters and expressive Spider-Verse light animation, it really stuck out and remained enjoyable the whole way through. Some parts are formulaic and follow the typical rom-com format, but I nonetheless still found myself invested in the central relationship, hoping it would work out. Good stuff, but don't put it on for the kids because they do the sex in this.
14.
12.
14.
Bodies, Bodies, Bodies is a fun little slasher murder mystery film with a bunch of very stupid characters. Normally that sounds like it would be frustrating, but it actually works out really well here and leads to a ton of fun moments as the film progresses. I actually got the murderer wrong as I kept adamantly thinking it was this one character, even after they supposedly died. And I said, oh, they're just faking it so they can kill more easily without anyone noticing. Nah, turns out, I'm just dumb. I wonder if Glass Onion will be on the list later. Anyway, only one way to find out, so let's keep going.
Number 11!
The Bat Guy is such an epic movie. I reviewed it back in March if you want to hear my thoughts there. But man, this is the single most satisfying silver screen adaptation of Batman there is. The film just oozes Batman in every aspect. And while it's not the most rewatchable thing for me, since it is a bit too long, it's nonetheless one of my favorite DC films to date. An easy recommendation if you've been living under a rock and haven't seen it yet. The Fablemans is a story about a kid named Steven Spielberg. He has a different name in the movie, but really, he's Steven Spielberg. I think it's honestly really cool of him to give us a movie like this at this stage of his career, where we can see a semi-fictionalized, but apparently mostly authentic account of how such a legendary filmmaker got started. You can see echoes of the Indiana Jones trilogy in the short films that Sammy creates, and watching his spark for filmmaking grow as time goes on is really compelling. Like a lot of people, I generally get a little annoyed when a movie obsessively goes into what an incredible, glorious joy making movies is. Like, I love the power that cinema holds, but hearing it described to me in an actual movie just kinda feels like pandering Oscar bait claptrap. But I don't know, it just feels really authentic here. If there's anyone who's earned the right to make a film like this, it's Spielberg. After it concluded, I felt an overwhelming urge to go watch the man's entire filmography. I don't know, I've thought about ranking director filmographies for a while, and I feel like this would be a good one to start with, right? You guys would click on that, right? It has Jaws, and E.T., and Jurassic Park, and Indiana Jones, and Ready Player One! Plus a bunch more serious and adult films that I never really get the chance to talk to you about, except in these best of the year rankings. I don't know, maybe I'll do it if you guys want me to. Watch The Fablemans, it's really good. Seth Rogen is in it, and he does the Seth Rogen laugh, and that's fine. Number 9. You guys ever see the movie Top Guy? It's not very good. Top Guy 2, however, now that one's a banger. When his best friend's son is like, I wanna fly a plane. Tom Cruise is like, no, you can't fly a plane. Go back to drumming for Omni-Man, you stupid kid. And it's crazy how a conflict so relatively cliche of a guy wanting to protect a child from doing the same thing that killed his father manages to be so emotionally effective. It's all in the execution, and I just thought these characters really worked and breathed fresh life into a familiar story. I like the camaraderie between all these new recruits and the way Tom Gunn interacts with them. I like how the movie uses nostalgia to create and enhance new emotions rather than just relying on it as a crutch. I liked Bob. But most of all, I like the scenes with the plane. They're really cool. Like, holy shit, the action in this movie is fucking insane. How did they do that? The entire final act of this movie is exhilarating and kept me on the edge of my seat throughout. In an era where legacy sequels overload you with empty nostalgia and then proceed to be forgotten about within a year, it's nice to get one that actually outshines the original and will most likely go down as a modern classic. See it for Bob, damn it. The Menu. That's right, The Menu. In this movie, Princess Peach goes to a wacky murder restaurant and wacky hijinks ensue. Sid the Sloth is there. I think I saw Lawrence Yee from Succession, which explains where he's been ever since he dropped off the face of the show after season 2. This movie was directed by a guy who directs a lot of Succession episodes. It reminds me of Succession a bit. Succession is one of the best TV shows I've ever seen in my life, and you should watch it. Sorry, what was I talking about? A lot of reviews I've read on Letterboxd seem to be very confused about the movie's message and what it's trying to say. They're comparing it to other rich people bad movies and saying the satire is toothless in comparison. Guys, must a movie have coherent satire? Is it not enough to just watch a funny restaurant thriller where Mr. Gustav serves people condiments without bread and then starts chopping their fingers off? If I had a nickel for every movie on this list where fingers get chopped off. Anyway, I had an absolutely delightful time with this movie from start to finish, and it made me really hungry for cheeseburgers, so I'm gonna go get some. Be right back. Please enjoy a word from our sponsor while I'm eating cheeseburger. Squarespace is a fantastic, intuitive, online website builder that allows you to create beautiful websites for your business or personal hobby. Present your work using Squarespace's professional portfolio designs. Display projects in customizable galleries and add password-protected pages to share private works with clients. You can even present your videos from YouTube, Vimeo, and Animoto on your Squarespace site. Add an image overlay to your video to improve your website's load speed by waiting to embed video players until playback starts. Every design automatically includes a unique mobile presence that matches the overall style of your website, so your content will look great on every device, every time. And if you don't want that, you can always disable the mobile view from Website Manager. Buying a domain from Squarespace is so simple because there are no hidden fees or price hikes. Each domain comes with an ad-free parking page and free WHOIS privacy on eligible domains. Squarespace sells over 200 top-level domains, so you can find the perfect name for your website. Choose a URL that ends in .com, .net, .org, or you can always get a more specific one like .art if you want to be fancy. If you're ready to share your passions or promote your business with the rest of the world, head to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/shayfrillis to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. I think on rewatch, Everything Everywhere All at Once has comfortably slid from an 8 out of 10 up to a 9 for me. I reviewed it when it came out last April, and while my thoughts from that video mainly still hold up, I clicked a bit more with the tone the movie was going for. Plus, having a better understanding of the rules of verse jumping helped me focus on and get a lot more invested in the character dynamics. Overall, it's a fantastic movie with great gags and a really strong emotional core. It's not quite an all-time favorite for me like it is for a lot of other people, but I'm nonetheless thrilled that a movie this ambitious and unforgettable and fun is getting the sort of award recognition that you really wouldn't expect. I guess every now and then, the Academy gives in to peer pressure and nominates a genre film that's both brilliant and fun, like Mad Max Fury Road, Get Out, or Parasite. And this is just the latest in their short, but steadily growing list of unconventional W decisions. It's not my favorite film of the year, nor my favorite Best Picture nominee, but I'll nonetheless be overjoyed if it manages to win. Like, Raccoony being in a Best Picture winner would literally be the best thing that ever happens to the Oscars. Number 6. There's been a lot of musician biopics lately. Some of them are good, some of them are Bohemian Rhapsody, and then there's Weird, the Al Yankovic story, which takes a look at the usual boring-ass biopic format and says, no thanks, here's a delightfully batshit insane, hilariously inaccurate parody of a biopic instead. This movie offered so many great and unexpected laughs, while also providing yet another delightfully silly role for Daniel Radcliffe's increasingly weird career. The cameos in this were on point. I won't spoil any of them, but I will warn you that one of them is Lin-Manuel Miranda, so please take extreme caution when viewing this. Anyway, I would say more, but I'm scheduled for my shift at the factory right now, so I gotta go. Bye! Number 5. Oh my god, it's Glass Onion. Can you believe it? I definitely didn't foreshadow it being here earlier. Anyway, this movie fucking rocks so hard. It's not quite as good as the first Knives Out for me, which, by the way, has shot up dramatically from the number 10 slot I gave it in my Best of 2019 video. Nowadays, it's definitely in the top 5 of that year for me. While this one falls a bit short, mainly due to its slower pace in the first half and slightly less compelling characters, it's still another funny, subversive, clever as all hell hybrid between a classic murder mystery and a deconstruction of just how dumb rich people can be. I love how the second film solidifies the franchise as having an overarching "Eat the Rich" theme, while also providing a neat mystery where the how done it is far more compelling to discover than the who. Unlike Bodies Times 3, I predicted the killer here right away, even before the killing got started. But I don't think having such an obvious culprit is really a detriment. It's still unbelievably satisfying to watch this silly Southern fried detective uncover the how and why, and the answer being in plain sight does fit with the theme and tie into revelations in the final act. Overall, a really tight, clever, and entertaining watch, cementing Benoit Blanc as one of my favorite fictional characters, and Rian Johnson as one of my favorite creatives working today. Like, who among us hasn't made a subpar Star Wars film in between directing the best episode of television and making a ton of fun, clever murder mysteries? This guy's good stuff far outshines the one shitty thing he made. Number 4. The Banshees of Inisherin is the most aggressively Irish thing I've ever seen. But you know what? I gotta respect that. Anyway, this movie is about two friends who split apart after the one friend decides he doesn't want to be friends anymore. It simultaneously manages to be an intensely bitter and sad film, while also having a great deal of strong comedy and absurdity to it. The tonal balance is struck in such a masterful way, and I was constantly either on the verge of tears or admiring just how silly this goofy little dude is as he tries and fails to get back with the guy who's pretty much his only friend. It's a film with a simple story that nonetheless manages to ask a ton of compelling questions about the nature of relationships and loneliness and what the best way to spend your limited time on Earth is. It's as deeply profound as it is surprisingly entertaining. but it's not my favorite movie of the year with a donkey in it. Initially, I had this film a little bit lower on the list, but then I realized that a movie I've watched 5 times in 1 month should probably be a bit higher. So without further ado, who is your favorite fearless hero? Who is your favorite fearless hero? Puss in Boots: The Last Wish is a miracle movie. I can't believe it's this good. After so many years of assuming the Shrek cinematic universe had nothing creative left to offer, in comes this gorgeously animated, expertly written, consistently funny, shockingly dramatic, absolute masterpiece of a film. Easily the best DreamWorks movie since the original How to Train Your Dragon. And seeing as how I've gone into excruciating detail about every one of the mainline Shrek movies, I think it's safe to say that this film will be getting its own dedicated long-form analysis vid. So stay tuned for that. Plus, you can check out my short review I made when it first came out. I'm sure at this point, everyone has known for a little while now how great this movie is. And if you're just finding this out now, oh, what took you so long, idiot? After Sun is a simultaneously tender and haunting film. Taking what seems like a simple, relatively uneventful vacation between an 11-year-old girl and her father, and forcing us to confront the underlying pain and lingering trauma the man is experiencing, while his daughter remains none the wiser. This film perfectly captures what a unique age 11 is, where you're still definitely a child, but just starting to long for a sense of independence and gain an understanding of the world around you. But it's still obviously not enough of an understanding for you to be equipped to heal your loved ones. You can see Sophie's lingering remorse over not being able to help her dad every time it cuts back to her as an adult. Even though as a child, it wasn't her responsibility to try and help him. This is a film that always hints at something darker bubbling underneath the surface, in between simple slice of life escapades at a resort. And as an audience member, it takes a little bit to figure out what's truly going on. But once everything clicks, the result is absolutely devastating. Excellent performances, a brilliant structure, purposeful direction, easily one of the year's best films, and one that's gonna stick with me for quite a while. But there's still one more I liked just a bit better. RRR is one of the greatest things I've ever seen in my life. You can't conceive of what this movie is capable of. It travels in worlds you can't even imagine. Lightning bolts shoot from its fingertips. I don't really have much of an emotional or intellectual take on this movie like I did with my favorite movies of the past 3 years. This one simply gets number one because it's literally everything you could ever ask for in a movie. There's action, there's bloodshed, there's betrayal, there's comedy, there's banger musical numbers. There's too many unbelievably jaw-dropping moments to count. And yet, at the center of it all is a deeply emotional story between these two immensely compelling and tragic men. You feel the connection between them, which makes so many of the plot developments throughout the film all the more devastating. There's a climactic battle in this that actually made me feel the emotions I was supposed to be feeling during the Anakin and Obi-Wan fight in Revenge of the Sith. Like, when I wasn't taking in the striking imagery and intense fight choreography, I was actively sobbing at how tragic the story was. And can we talk about the action for a second? Probably the best I've seen in any movie, period. It is insane how much the spectacle consistently ramps up throughout this movie's incredibly justified 3.5-hour runtime. I don't even want to risk saying too much more, because I don't want to reveal too many of the seemingly endless list of surprises this movie has in store. It's on Netflix. Carve some time out of your day to watch it because it's absolutely more than worth it. Also, if any of you are more well-versed in Indian cinema than I am, please feel free to recommend me some other Indian films. I've only seen this and Three Idiots, and I'm sure there's many more amazing pieces of Indian cinema out there that an uncultured swine like me has never heard of before. Anyway, that's about it. Good night, Tri-State Area.